Penguin Random House Audio presents True Story, a novel by Kate Reed Petty. Read for you by Kristen Sieh, Alexander Cendese, and Cassandra Campbell.
We Are, I Am, You Are. By cowardice or courage, the one who find our way. Back to this scene, carrying a knife, a camera, a book of myths, in which our names do not appear. Adrian Rich, diving into the wreck. Prologue. Barcelona, 2015. When you last came to ask for this story, I'd already been hiding out in Barcelona for years. I live in an airy studio on the top floor of a 5-story building, with tile floors and a big sliding glass door that opens onto a patio. The patio is lined with terracotta pots, too heavy to move, left by the previous tenants, and overflowing with succulents. The apartment is inexpensive and private. The neighbors keep to themselves, and the landlord likes her checks in the mail. It took a little while, but now I feel safe enough here that on hot nights, I don't close the patio door, leaving my bedroom open to the breeze whispering up from the city streets and to the phantom intruders that used to haunt my dreams. I love this apartment, the way astronauts love their ships. My only complaint is the display in the window of the pharmacy downstairs, which I pass every day on my morning run. It features 3 female mannequins with rounded onyx surfaces where their faces should be, their arms and legs cut off at the biceps and thighs. They've been arranged in come-hither poses, hips torqued out as though they were modeling bikinis, but instead they model first aid equipment. The one closest to my apartment door has a black lumbar support belt strapped around her waist like a corset, and a blue sling for a broken arm draped around her neck. Perched in a wheelchair to her left, another has a knee brace attached at the thigh. The third leans stiffly against the far wall, a sleep mask covering the place where her eyes should be. For months and months now, this display hasn't changed. Try as I might to look away, I can't help glancing at it as I pass, the way a woman in a horror movie can't resist going upstairs. Don't take this the wrong way, but whenever I look at the mannequins, I think of you. My oldest friend, you have always stood by me in the face of casual misogyny and bad taste. When you came to Barcelona, I really did intend to meet you at your hotel as I'd said I would. But then I got to the street and found myself walking in the opposite direction. I needed time to think. It was one of those abundant late summer days, and I walked in a wide arc under orange trees ruffling their leaves in the sun. I passed old women walking arm in arm, families pushing children on swings in clean public playgrounds. I walked all the way to the Parc de la Ciutadella, where green parrots bobbled around, mingling with pigeons on the paving stones. I didn't mean to stand you up. I told myself I was circling around to approach your hotel from the opposite side, but then I just kept circling. Eventually, I walked back to my apartment. I turned off my phone, then went out and sat on my wide patio in the afternoon sun and finished a mystery novel whose ending I'd guessed from the start. I fell asleep for a while, and when I woke up, I cooked a more complicated dinner than I usually bother to. Pasta with olives and artichoke hearts, an endive salad on the side. It was delicious. Only when the dishes were clean did I finally call your hotel. I'm sure you thought I was still angry. The truth is, I was embarrassed. You've always been the one who was brave. No, the one who was sure. You've always been so sure of the story you want me to tell. The story you've been asking me for since we were 17. The story about the things that happened while I was asleep. It's your story, you would say. If you don't let it out, it will take over your life. But the story is mine only as the victim owns the prosecution, or the whale the harpoon. Telling it has always been the privilege of the perpetrators, who have the actual facts, and of the bystanders, like you, who believe they know. Back then, I wasn't ready to explain. So I told the receptionist not to call your room, just to give you the message that I'd been summoned to London on short notice by a demanding client. Tell her not to wait for me, I said. I'm not sure when I'll return. Then I turned off my phone again and went back out to the patio. I watched the lights blinking on across the city like eyes, a constellation of night watchmen. I hoped you would accept my excuse, though I knew it was obviously false. Now I hope you'll accept this instead. Satan's Brides by Alice Lovett and Haley Moreland, 9/1/95. Fade in. Interior. A one-room cabin in the woods. Night. Lisa is sitting alone with a bottle of red wine and a pint of ice cream. She's been crying. Her makeup is all smeared. Lisa. I can't believe that bastard. Lisa gulps down an entire glass of wine. She wipes her mouth. She throws the glass across the room. The glass shatters. Lisa. 15 years of marriage, and he leaves me for Francesca. Lisa flops forward face down onto the table. She wails. Lisa. Why, Jim? Why? She reaches over and takes a big bite of ice cream. Lisa, wailing. This ice cream isn't even that good. Suddenly, there is a loud thump on the door. Lisa jumps. She stands up. She stares at the door. Lisa, hesitantly. Who is it? Lisa slowly opens the door and sees there is a large knife stuck point first in the face of the door. Lisa screams and slams the door closed. Then, she hears the sound of a woman laughing evilly. Lisa spins around. Lisa, who's there? There's no one else in the room. But the ice cream pint has been knocked over. There's a puddle of melted ice cream on the table. Lisa, oh my God. Lisa sees that someone has dragged a finger through the melted ice cream, spelling out, Satan still loves you. Lisa screams. Lisa runs to the door and flings it open. She grabs the knife. Then she flees. Exterior. The woods at night. Continuous. Lisa runs through the woods, panicked, looking back over her shoulder. She trips. She falls. The knife flies out of her hand. Woman. Off screen. Evil. Hi, Lisa. Lisa looks up. It's Francesca. A beautiful woman with heavy red lipstick and thick blue eyeshadow. Lisa. Francesca? Francesca. Happy to see me. Lisa. No, you stole my husband. Francesca is witheringly condescending. Francesca. I didn't steal your husband. I distracted him. I really want you. Lisa scrambles backward. She's edging closer to the knife. Francesca, I stole Jim so that you would come to your vacation cabin alone. Lisa, why did you do that? Francesca, because I want you to join us. Lisa, join who? Francesca, the brides of Satan. Lisa, what? Francesca, your husband is tied to a tree back there. All you have to do is sacrifice him with that knife. And then Satan will make us both all-powerful. Lisa leans over and picks up the knife, considers it. Lisa. So all I have to do is kill Jim? Francesca. Think of how easily he left you. Lisa. Like this? Lisa lunges forward and stabs Francesca in the heart. Francesca screams and falls to her knees. Francesca. We could have been all powerful. Francesca dies. Lisa stands, catching her breath. She looks up and off into the woods. She realizes. Lisa. Jim! I'm coming! Fade to black.
Part 1. Lax World, 1999. In the fall of our senior year, My buddy Max Platt was arrested for shining a laser pointer at an airplane. We didn't even know this was illegal. It was one of the least bad things Max ever did, and it was hilarious that it ended up being the thing he got in trouble for. This was still a few months before the whole thing with the private school girl.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.